The three final degrees this evening are honorary. However, have no doubt they have been very well earned. Our recipients this evening have distinguished themselves by committed service in a variety of areas which have touched and transformed the lives of many. Our first honorary degree is a doctorate in theology. It is awarded to persons whose research and teaching, either in formal settings or through their lifestyle, deepen in others an awareness and understanding of the mystery of our loving God. Tonight's recipient of the honorary doctorate in theology is Reverend Bryan Massingale. I now invite Professor Dawn Noteware, Professor of Catholic Theological Ethics, to come forward to read the citation, and President Senior will then confer the degree.
Bryan N. Massingale was the first of his extended family to graduate from college. He received the Bachelor of Arts degree summa cum laude from Marquette University in 1979. At one point in the festivities, Bryan showed his grandmother his diploma. Glowing with pride, she turned to Bryan and said, "Look at that. That sure is something. Now, who are you going to help with it? Who are you going to use it for?" Thus was born a Black Catholic scholar activist. In 1983, he obtained the Master of Divinity degree with high honors from St. Francis Seminary and was ordained to the Roman Catholic priesthood for the Archdiocese of Milwaukee. In 1988, he earned the licentiate of sacred theology from the Catholic University of America, and then in 1991, he received the doctorate of sacred theology in moral theology, summa cum laude, from Rome's Academia Alphonsianum. Today, as a world-renowned moral theologian, Bryan Massingale holds appointments as professor of theology at Marquette University and at the Institute for Black Catholic Studies in Xavier University of Louisiana. He is a past president of the Catholic Theology Society of America and past convener of the Black Catholic Theological Symposium. A prolific author and commentator, he has publications in numerous academic journals, pastoral ministry publications, and catechetical resources. As a stellar teacher, Father Massingale is in constant demand by universities, pastoral settings, and professional audiences. Bryan N. Massingale, as a Black Catholic moralist, has broken new ground by promoting the vocation of the theologian as a scholar activist. He understands his vocation as a loving response to mystery. He is a Black Catholic theologian, yet also a race-transcending prophet, who is characterized by faithfulness in the midst of persistent difficulties, humbleness in service, a willingness to speak unpopular, uncomfortable, and yet necessary truths, and a commitment to the life of the mind for the sake of social and ecclesial transformation. Thus, out of deep love for the church, Father Massingale is willing to challenge today's church. In his classic award-winning book, Racial Justice and the Catholic Church, he asked, "What would Catholic ethics look like if it took the Black experience seriously as a dialogue partner?" But with equal passion, Father Massingale teaches, "The society we live in is the outcome of human choices and decisions. What humans break, divide, and separate, we can, with God's help, also heal, unite, and restore. Therein lies the hope and the challenge. In recognition of the singular accomplishments of this distinguished visionary and prophetic scholar activist, the faculty and board of trustees of Catholic Theological Union are proud to confer upon Reverend Bryan and Massingale the title of Doctor of Theology, Honoris Causa.
Too much paper to juggle. The Almighty has done great things for me, and holy is God's name. I am grateful and humbled, Father Senior and the faculty and administration of CTU, for this recognition. I make my living in part by crafting words, and my writings have been honored as being powerful and poetic and even prophetic, yet they fail me now. I look around at this impressive faculty here at CTU, and I see so many colleagues and friends and scholars, people whose lives have inspired me, whose prayers have uplifted me, whose witness has challenged me, and all of you are deserving of this recognition. And so I begin with thanks. Thanks both to the Almighty and to the faith-filled community of CTU for this recognition. Now, I was told that I had to be brief, profound, and brief. So I will do my best to honor this request. I'm going to frame my remarks around an understanding of vocation, given that this is the largest Catholic school of ministry in the United States. In honoring me tonight, CTU does more than recognize me as a scholar or as a person. It also honors a particular understanding of theology and a particular way of doing theology. People ask me, well, what is a theologian and what is theology? And I always have this definition. Theology is passionate participation in reasoned discourse on behalf of God's oppressed and despised people. Like all theologians, I seek to advance an understanding of the church's faith and its inexhaustible implications for how we live our lives. But for me, theology, above all else, is a never-ceasing exploration of the life of the one who claimed to be good news for the poor. By being passionate about God's passion for those who are despised, disdained, and dismissed, both in church and in society, that passion, God's passion, I believe is an indispensable component for those who profess to be Christians and scholars in service for the faith community. It is my privileged task to speak on behalf of those who are muted and silenced, on behalf of people like Tyler Clemente and Trayvon Martin, and the nameless people who die in New Mexico and Arizona deserts in search for a better life. That, to me, is theology. And so CTU is making a statement not simply about me. It's making a statement about a particular way of being a theologian, of being part of a community of scholars who understand themselves not only to be teacher scholars, but more importantly, as scholar activists. For that indeed is the acid test of a theologian. It doesn't lie in the achievement of awards and wonderful hoods and fancy clothes, as much as those are appreciated, but in the willingness to speak unpopular, uncomfortable, and life-giving truths on behalf of those whose voices in church and society can be dismissed and disdained. Which leads to my second note. And I'm so glad I did this because, Dawn, you stole the way I was going to conclude it with my grandmother's story. It was a wonderful story. But I want to conclude with another note that came to me just this afternoon as I wrote two endings for this. A word to the graduates who are about to embark upon and deepen a life of commitment to God's people. Note earlier I said that theology is passionate participation in reasoned discourse on behalf of God's oppressed and despised people, those who are dismissed and despised and disdained even in the church. And that is not a throwaway line. I mean it deeply. Many, too many, find the church a difficult and tiring experience. As I said in my book, many, too many experience themselves as a motherless child, even in the arms of an institution we sometimes call Holy Mother Church. We find ourselves today in a faith community rife with polarization and recrimination and even denunciation. What Karl Rahner once called an ecclesial winter is deeply upon us. When I was the president of the Catholic Theological Society of America, the theme I chose for the convention was impasse and beyond. And in many ways, we are in a moment of impasse, when the way forward is unclear, uncertain, and even at times unavailable. Connie Fitzgerald, a discalced Carmelite nun, she writes in one of her essays, "The question before us is this: can we believe that the darkness of this empty time and barren space is the love and care of God in our lives, desiring to purify our desires as persons and our dreams as people?" Impasse, darkness, emptiness, is paradoxically a sign of God's closeness, a consequence of God expanding, even exploding, our horizons and understandings of God, opening us to new visions, new possibilities, new ways of living with each other and being church. Our confusion, our grappling, our groping, our pain, I believe paradoxically is a sign that God is drawing near and doing a new thing in us, among us, and with us. And so as you enter into ministry or go back to your far-flung places, I wish I had more to offer you, more answers, but unfortunately, we're all in this together. But as we seek to serve a church in this dark and difficult time, all I can offer is a reminder and a hope. The reminder is this: we cannot, we dare not abandon a commitment to be present to God's despised and disdained people. For they are the privileged place of the encounter with God. Upon that, our faith is clear, and upon that, we must take an unequivocal stand. And the hope is this: that the trials of the present herald a new advent or coming of God. This ecclesial darkness marks the dawn of a new age in the church, one that we don't cause, we just give witness to. And so my prayer for you, especially you graduates, is this: that you have the eyes to see and you can be the eyes for others that can see in this empty time and barren space and challenging time the love and the care of God, drawing us to horizons beyond our imaginings. For as scripture says, eye has not seen and ear has not heard, nor has it dawned upon us what God has prepared for those who love. May God, who's begun the good work in you, bring it to fulfillment.